People of God, the gospel, the good news according to St. Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them off into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others still standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' And they said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' So he told them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborer and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.'" Notice that order. "When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the gospel, the good news of our Lord." Grace to you and peace from God, our Creator, from Jesus, the Savior, and from the Holy Spirit, our Comforter and Guide, let the people of God say, Amen. If you have small children, or if at some point in your life you have raised kids, you're very familiar with this common complaint. It's not fair. Your five-year-old daughter sees that her little brother has gotten lots of gifts for his birthday, and she doesn't have a single new toy. It's not fair. Your teenage son snags the last piece of fried chicken during Sunday dinner, and his younger brother pipes up, "It's not fair." The teacher clearly favors a particular student, calling on them, giving them good grades, even letting them off easy with homework. And the whole rest of the class cries out, "You know what's coming. It's not fair." Yes, it's not fair. See, fairness is one of those values we like to think of as particularly American, right? An American value, because we like to believe that our whole system of government is built on fairness. Everyone is equal. Everyone gets the same chances and opportunity, and in this fair and equal society, you can even pull yourself up on your bootstraps if you find yourself in dire circumstances. Well, today's lesson from the Gospel of Matthew has something to say about fairness. Can't you just hear these workers who have worked all day long and gotten the same pay as these others who came late in the afternoon? Can't you just hear them complain? But it's not fair. If you've been following the news, you've heard, of course, about the strike that's going on right now, right? That's currently underway. The United Auto Workers are striking against the big three automakers to get higher pay and better job security. The big three are Ford, General Motors, and, wait for it, no, not Chrysler, Stellantis. Did I say that right? Yes, Stellantis. I don't know about you, but for me, you know, that's a name I have to get used to. I mean, what's wrong with Chrysler anyway? Why can't they just leave well enough alone? All right, enough of that rant. What I want to point out is that at its most basic, the current labor dispute is about fairness. In fact, you could argue that the fight between the UAW and the automakers is a modern-day version of Jesus' parable of the workers in the vineyard. They are demanding higher wages, arguing that they have lost buying power, that their income, adjusted for inflation, has actually gone down since the Great Recession of 2008 by something like 20%. Meanwhile, company profits at the big three automakers are at an all-time high. Did you know that in the first 6 months of this year, those three companies made a combined $21 billion in profit? Billion with a B. So the striking workers are out there on the picket line chanting, you know what's coming, it's not fair. And indeed it isn't. While overall pay for workers has eroded, compensation for the CEOs has skyrocketed. Last year alone, Mary Barra, boss of General Motors, made $29 million. That's 362 times the median employee pay. Ford's CEO, Jim Farley, clocked in at $21 million, and his salary has doubled since 2020. So in this light, the union's demand for a 40% increase in wages over 4 years seems quite reasonable to me, even though it sounds like a lot. Back in 2007, when the automakers were in trouble in the run-up to the Great Recession that would follow, the union made significant concessions, giving up pensions and cost-of-living increases. And now that the auto market is booming and profits are pouring in, it only seems fair that the workers should get some raises, that they would participate in all of that. On some level, it's about economic justice. And I think that's true for the parable as well, right? These parables, the parable of the workers in the vineyard, is about economic justice, not just fairness. See, the workers that are hired early in the morning work in the vineyard all day long, working hard in the heat of the day. Those hired in the afternoon and then even later in the evening, well, of course they work a lot less. They have many less hours, but they all get paid the same wages. On the surface, that is not fair. And those workers who have been at it all day make no bones about it. They complain loudly to the vineyard owner. These last ones works only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. The owner's reply, of course, is that he can do with his money what he wants. I'm doing you no wrong, he says. I paid you what we agreed on. Are you envious because I'm generous? Well, first up, I want to take some issue with this owner. Actually, he isn't all that generous at all. You see, the typical daily wage was 1 denarius. A denarius was a silver coin issued by the Roman Empire containing about 3.4 grams of silver and worth maybe 20 cents at the time. Here's what these coins looked like. They always had the emperor's picture on them, here of Caesar Augustus, ruler of the Roman Empire in Jesus' time. That was the usual wage of a soldier or a laborer for 1 day of work. As Matthew puts it in the parable, it was the usual daily wage. But it wasn't particularly generous. 1 denarius was barely enough for a family to exist on in poverty. Think of it as a kind of a minimum wage that kept you barely above water. The owner of the vineyard may have been generous to the workers who had come late to the party, but overall he was paying poverty wages, and therefore he can't be considered all that generous. The usual daily wage of 1 denarius was not enough to make a decent living, just like today's minimum wage of $7.25 an hour is nowhere near enough to meet all of a family's need. So in doing the research for this sermon, I found out that in 2023, a living wage for a single person in Wake County is $18.51. That's what a single person without any dependents would need to make to meet the basic expenses, you know, mortgage or rent and food and transportation and so on. For two adults with one child, that wage would be $2,182. This is data that comes from a study done by the Department of Urban Studies and Planning of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. You can look it up. They have it for every county in the country. You can see right away how inadequate the official minimum wage of $7.25 an hour really is. I mean, at minimum wage, you'd have to work two full-time jobs, and you'd still make less than $15 an hour, and you would fall below a living wage. So I think what Jesus is talking about in this parable and what we can take away from it is that Jesus is not talking just about economic justice, but he's talking about equity as opposed to equality. See, equality means everyone is treated the same exact way, regardless of need or any other individual difference. In a sense, that's what the vineyard workers expect. Pay based on number of hours worked, the same wage for everyone paid out according to their labors. That's equality. Equity, on the other hand, means everyone is provided with what they need to succeed. So the vineyard owner pays the latecomers what they need to survive for that day. That's equity. And as you can see from this classic illustration, equality isn't enough to make a just society. It's like that old image of poor people pulling themselves up by their bootstraps when some of them don't even have boots. Jesus' vision, on the other hand, is a vision of against the grain existence, a reversal of cultural understanding that calls for equity, not just equality, that calls for fairness, not just compassion, that reaches out to the least of these and makes the last the first. And isn't that just how God's grace works? Let's not forget that Jesus begins this story with the words, "For the kingdom of heaven is like." And then he contrasts God's unconditional love and amazing grace with the harsh realities of our own expectations. That doesn't always sit well with us. You know, too often we think of ourselves as the vineyard workers who were hired early in the day and who are now being cheated by the owner, i.e. God, who treats the latecomers in a generous way. I mean, we are the good guys, right? We go to church, we do good deeds, we pray for a better world, we give money to feed the hungry, we sacrifice for the sake of our poor neighbors. Why should we be treated the same as those other people who are lazy, stand around idle all day, don't lift a finger for their neighbors, do all kinds of evil deeds? Why should God love these no good people equally? Why should we bother and try so hard to live a good, God-pleasing life when in the end, the last shall be first? Well, here's why. In God's eyes, we all have fallen short of God's expectations. Martin Luther famously said that we have to sin. We cannot help ourselves. And Paul wrote in a letter to the Romans that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Hard as we might try, we all fall short. So it's a good thing for us too that God's grace is always amazing grace, poured out equally over saints and sinners and everyone in between. If it was up to us, if we had to earn our way into God's kingdom, none of us would ever make it. In that sense, all of us sitting here and listening online, we are those workers who are hired last and who will be first in God's kingdom, not because we deserve it, not because we have earned it, but simply because God loves us with an overwhelming, everlasting, even reckless kind of love. So rather than to give in to jealousness and self-absorbed egotism, Let's celebrate that we worship a God who loves us, all of us, each of us, so much that this God would incarnate God's self and become human in the person of Jesus Christ. God loves us. God loves you with an overwhelming, never-ending, everlasting, even reckless kind of love. We could never earn it, regardless of how early we might start in the morning. We don't deserve it. Regardless of how hard we might try to please God with all that we do and say all day long, God's love is unconditional. God's grace is amazing. God's grace and mercy is for everyone, equitably. And all we can do is sing about it. So let's do just that.